Across Britain, thousands of historic buildings have been neglected. Their owners struggling to restore them because of planning restrictions, design problems, or lack of money. Luckily, some romantics do take on the challenge of converting and restoring these forgotten gems. But it isn't for the faint-hearted.
It's sat here and it's falling apart.
I think it can push you to the limit, actually.
We have to find a way of getting this done, because if we don't, then we lose everything.
They're often churches, mills and barns.
But also factories, warehouses and industrial buildings that are often abandoned because they're so difficult for residential conversion. These buildings have as much rich history and tell as many fascinating stories about our past as any stately home or medieval castle.
These are palaces of industry, and so it's such a privilege to live in one.
As an architect, I relish the challenge that these unusual buildings give us when we're trying to create a place called home.
This time, a young couple attempt to restore a World War II RAF bunker.
Certainly the most ambitious thing I've ever taken on, I think.
Something tells me that you've got a bit of a damp problem.
And I uncover its remarkable military history.
It's one of the most incredible projects I've ever seen.
On the outskirts of Nottingham lies the small village of Watnall. Off an ordinary trunk road down a muddy track, there's a hidden secret. A giant 15,000 square foot 1940s military bunker.
First came across the bunker about 3.5 years ago. I saw an auction sign. Absolutely blown away by the place.
It's one of three underground bunkers which formed part of the World War II RAF Fighter Command headquarters in the Midlands. Jamie Brown paid just £72,000 for this giant muddy embankment, having never undertaken a restoration before.
It was one of those things where I had to have it.
When you first bought it, I mean, I thought you were crazy and really thought, what on earth's going on? He was like a little kid, he was really excited, and it was just like he'd found this lost world down here.
Jamie, who runs his own furniture business, married Jane, a hotel manager, in 2012, who is now expecting their first child. Jamie persuaded Jane to come on board because he wanted to turn the bunker into their home, but with a long-term plan for them to transform it into a World War II-themed B&B.
Certainly the most ambitious thing I've ever taken on, I think. And I've, you know, obviously chuffed a bit as I found somebody like Jane who was mad enough to put up with a guy like me.
I've never seen a conversion and restoration like this before. It's a massive 15,000 square feet, and it's their first ever building project. I'm already apprehensive, but eager to find out more about this ambitious challenge.
Hello there.
You Jamie? Right? Yeah, not too bad, Jane.
Hey, nice to meet you.
What is this?
It looks like it's been hit by a bomb.
Just a little excavation, just to sort of get a scale of what's there.
You're going to make this into your home?
Yeah.
That is quite an incredible, ambitious, mad and crazy project.
Yeah.
Why?
For those very reasons. No, it's just something that's very, very unique, very different. It's a one-off.
It's incredible.
Yes.
Can I see what it's like inside?
Yeah, yeah, let's take you in.
What I'm seeing is just the tip of the iceberg. The bunker was built in 1941 and took 2 years to build. Known as the filter block, the military personnel here analysed radar information and passed on enemy aircraft positions to the control centre at RAF Watnall nearby. It's made up from a network of corridors and rooms constructed from bomb-proof concrete over two floors, and was designed around a large central atrium with ventilation plant rooms at the back. Having been left derelict for 50 years, it's now a dark, dank dungeon.
Oh, bought? What on earth have you bought? It's a bit dark.
It gets dark here.
It gets darker than this. How can it possibly get darker than this?
As we explore further, the scale of this gigantic bunker has become an even more evident. And Jamie's keen to show me the nerve centre of this epic building.
This is where the whole project opens up.
Oh my God! I don't think I've ever seen anything like it in my life.
Once home to a busy operations room, this 20-foot-high atrium is now enclosed in total darkness. But during World War II, this would have been teeming with military personnel, identifying RAF and enemy aircraft positions from radar signals.
If you buy your everyday, you know, barn you want to convert and everything else, you've got your project, you've got your 6 months, you've got your 12 months, 18 months, whatever it's going to be. Once that's done, it's done. Game over, you've done what you wanted to achieve in everything else. This, for us, is something that we'll get as far as we can, but we know it's going to be something that we're just going to continuously have as a project.
I don't think my mum would like it. But as an architect, I can see the potential. It's really brilliant. It's big,
sound.
Big, solid lump of space, isn't it?
Shall we carry on?
Yeah,
for sure. Let's take you down.
With no windows, electrics or natural light, this project is already challenging. But to add to the list, there's major flooding in the basement.
Oh my God. It's a lake.
Yes.
What on earth is that over there? What's that?
This is all the main electrics substation, if you like, for the operations bunker.
I mean, you know, call me Sherlock Holmes, but something tells me that you've got a bit of a damp problem. Look at it! It's a bloody lake down here!
40 years of constant seepage and rising damp has created a candy floss coating of mould on the brick walls.
Can I just say something? This is ridiculous. It's absolutely stark raving.
Just mind the lip as you
bonkers.
Step in the room.
Oh, my God! It's unbelievable!
This is the filter rooms. So that's where all the air used to come in or get drawn in from the outside and then pumped around the bunker.
I mean, this is tons and tons of metal and ducting and gear and... I've never seen anything like it.
You talked about period features.
It goes against the grain of everything that a family home should be when you think of kind of comfort and warmth and natural light and ventilation and being able to open doors and run out in the garden and stuff like that. This just hasn't got any of it.
Yet.
Yeah, take it down.
Jamie has spent nearly 3 years working on the plans with an architect. Because the bunker isn't listed, they began with a blank canvas, and now they have planning permission to start a three-phase build. Phase one is a 3,500 square foot glass extension, which wraps around the front and side of the bunker. This includes an apartment on the first floor, which Jamie and Jane can move into temporarily. This will eventually become part of their B&B. Below is a garage for two cars with storage and utility room. Phase two will consist of 5 ensuite bedrooms over 2 floors, which is where they plan to accommodate their guests for the B&B. The central atrium will become a large open communal guest area. Finally, phase three, at the back of the bunker, will eventually become a 3-bedroom home for Jamie and Jane.
It's a fantastic project, and the way you're phasing it, I think it's really good. It's just a big project. It is massive.
I'm still fairly young, still got many years to go.
Are you doing any of the work yourself or not?
There's no way we can't get involved with this, and there's no way we could just command somebody to say, you know, here's your money, get on with it and look after it for us. We just couldn't do that, not that sort of people.
When do you expect to move in? When does phase one expect to be completed?
I would love to think we would be in some capacity for Christmas, so 6 months, but I know that is a bloody tall order.
You'll never be in by Christmas.
No, it's quite possible.
Jamie's plans sound very ambitious, but there's one giant elephant in the room.
What's your budget for phase one?
We've put ourselves a fairly conservative budget of 300,000.
300 grand is a large amount of money, obviously. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of cash.
Yeah.
But this is a massive building.
Oh, for sure.
And because of the amount of engineering and the structural stuff you've got to do, and
a building as big as this, it get gobbled up really, really fast.
I love Jamie's optimism, but I'm seriously worried that both the finance and schedule aren't realistic. However, this is a magnificent part of Britain's World War II history and a building I hope he can resurrect.
Once in a while, a very, very special project comes along, something that gets you absolutely buzzing and excited about its potential. This, for me, is like the restoration equivalent of an archaeologist finding the most beautiful buried treasure. But for Jim and Jamie, this honestly could be the challenge of a lifetime.
Jamie and Jane Brown have bought a World War II bunker, which they want to renovate and turn into their future home and a themed B&B. It's a three-phase project, but for the moment they're concentrating on phase one, a small apartment at the front of the building, which they hope to complete in 6 months' time. But before they can start, heavy snowfall throughout January delays any work on this sleeping giant. With the snow finally melted, excavation has begun to remove a staggering 25,000 tons of earth that encloses the side of the bunker. Jane has just given birth to their first child, baby Harry, so this couple will have their hands full in the coming months.
Crikey.
Oh my word, he's right on top of the front door.
Still can't quite get my head around it.
The bunker was built into the side of an escarpment, and as the earth is removed, it's revealed an impressive protective blast wall with buttressing. The snow and a recently discovered natural spring has caused further flooding to the building. This needs to be resolved before moving on to any further structural work.
Problem is, when we started excavating around the back corner, we dug away and it looks like either an old feed into the building or the natural springs pumping up by the back door and coming in. We need to try and contain that spring.
As the excavation of the mud opens up new design possibilities, Jamie is already considering changing his plans. So I've come back to find out if I can help.
Jamie, how are you?
Morning, you well?
Not bad. Look, there's a mud bath.
Welcome back.
This is unbelievable. I mean, the mud was about halfway up that front wall the last time I was here.
Yeah, no, totally.
Completely submerged. You've dug all of that out.
Down the side, down the back. It took about 3.5-4 weeks. A whole lot, front to back. About 25,000 tonnes of soil.
25,000 tonnes?
We've still got it all on site at the moment.
It's like revealing a kind of Egyptian tomb.
Let's go and have a wander out inside.
The original plan was to have a wraparound extension encasing the southwest side of the building. But now the giant wall with its buttresses has been revealed, Jamie has a new idea.
Before, we were going to live in here, basically, exposing this wall. It just seems such a shame to bury and hide what we've bought and what we're trying to do. So we're trying to use that wall of the bunker now, putting the windows into this wall, solving the natural daylight inside.
This is a major civil engineering exercise. This isn't a bit of tinkering. This is big-scale engineering stuff.
Jamie's new plan is to open up the south-facing side of the building by cutting giant holes that will form new windows and feed natural light into the heart of the building. He proposes to change his original atrium design. The communal guest area will now be single-storey, with the 5 guest bedrooms being placed above on the first floor. Local planning officer Michael Bruce is visiting site to assess the new plans.
particularly with a listed building, you get all your consents in place and then you stick to it. Mm-hmm. This one seems to be kind of adapting and changing as you uncover things.
Yeah. Well, it's an unusual case. I mean, that stands to reason. And we were expecting it to change and to evolve as time went on, because I don't think Jamie really knew what he had at first.
So is this going to be a minor amendment, or is it a full application?
I think we're looking for, there's discussions about a minor material amendment at the moment to see whether or not the council can look at it within that scope. If it's acceptable, then obviously we will approve that.
Jamie will have to wait for final sign-off before he can start work on the new scheme. Meanwhile, he can spend the time demolishing any unwanted internal walls.
So I brought you in for the week, yeah?
It's great to finally get hands-on with the build, but I'm keen to find out what Jane thinks about Jamie's grand plans. She's currently on maternity leave with baby Harry, and looking forward to moving out of their small house.
I mean, to go from a brand new build to an old restoration project, that's 15 times bigger, roughly, than what you're in now, is unbelievable.
He bought it before we were married, so it was his baby, if you like, and then he had to convince me to come on board and go for it. And there's no way that we could have gone ahead with this if just he wanted to do it, because it's a family thing. And, you know, now we need to think about what we're all going to do as a family. Mm-hmm. So I think he would have been absolutely gutted if I'd have said, I don't want to go ahead with it.
I want to find out more about the bunker's celebrated past. So I've come to meet military historian Stephen Bungay at RAF Uxbridge to see a bunker preserved in its original 1940s condition.
This is it.
This is it.
I hope the visit will bring to life how our bunker functioned, as they both shared similar roles during World War II.
We're standing here at the very heart of the UK air defence system. It was the first in the world, and it was the first time that anybody had actually solved the incredibly difficult problem of detecting enemy aircraft, enabling your own defenders to go up and meet them and bring back those defenders to home.
Our bunker was part of a network that spread across the country. They were built underground to be bomb-proof so that hundreds of military personnel could work safely and secretly. Each one had a central control room where the Women's Auxiliary Air Force mapped the positions of incoming enemy aircraft using radar technology.
Each board represents a squadron, and yep, above it is the sector station that it's based at.
Each column would tell the commanding officers how many planes they had at their disposal and at which airfield.
Here you've got an image of the battle space.
The map below gave detailed information of what the radar and observation stations around the country were reporting.
And you see those arrows there?
Yep.
Those are indications of the position of the hostile forces.
Knowing the information on the map and what planes they had at their disposal from the columns meant the RAF Fighter Command could mobilise incredibly quickly on an unsuspecting enemy.
I mean, we would have probably lost the war if it wasn't for this.
This is at the heart of the reason that we were able to win the Battle of Britain. I think it's one of the greatest intellectual and practical achievements of the 20th century.
Although this revolutionary new system of defence dramatically improved Britain's chances in the war, it did have one Achilles heel. At night time, the pilots were flying blind, unable to target the enemy, as was proved on one fateful night, which was experienced by the personnel in our bunker. On the 14th of November 1940, around 500 German bombers cruised by the dead of night over nearby Coventry and dropped 500 tons of high explosives. I've managed to find a war veteran who worked at RAF Watnall during what's now famously known as the Coventry Blitz, which killed hundreds of people. Hilda Hill worked in the control centre and remembers vividly what went on in the ops room on that tragic night.
So, Hilda, tell me about the Coventry Blitz. I was on duty the night of the Coventry Blitz. I did manage to peep through and see the potting table. The girls were absolutely frantic, pushing their clues around.
Did you see it?
When I came off duty, you could see the smoke and you could hear the bombs going off. It was terrible. The feeling. Horror. Frightening. It made you realise why you were in the services, what you were doing. And you couldn't do enough.
As a consequence of the Blitz, the Air Defence Network improved the technology, which included installing radars inside night fighters. And Jamie and Jane's bunker played a vital role in coordinating these nation-saving attacks. 2 months later, Jamie has finally got the go-ahead for his new plans, and he's fixed the flooding on the ground floor. They can now start the long, hard process of cutting holes into the thick, bomb-proof reinforced concrete walls to let light into the subterranean building for the first time in its history.
Absolutely unbelievable! The power and the force in this bit of kit is mind-boggling! So often it's about tinkering with things, you know, being very delicate with a listed building. Not this one.
On the inside, they can now concentrate on sandblasting all of the internal brickwork and making the building watertight.
How cool is that? That is a proper boy's toy, that is.
Seriously, does some damage.
I want one. Any chance I can pick up the reins?
Yeah.
Straight in. That is unbelievable.
You might need a bit more training.
I think I need a lot more training. Oh man, I shouldn't pull my back. To break through a wall this thick with all this. Come, look at that. All this is an absolute ton. And all this super strong steel reinforcement gripping all that concrete together. If you did this by hand, this is weeks of work for two or three guys. But when you've got this, it just goes through like a knife through a butter.
Internally, things are cracking on too. In order for Jamie's giant windows to fit perfectly, the only tool that will slice through the 19-inch reinforced concrete walls is a circular diamond-bladed cutter. This building has revealed exactly why it's called bomb-proof.
It's unbelievable. When you're standing at this highest point of this massive bunker, you just get a real sense of the scale of this thing. It's one giant monolithic structure. It's one of the most incredible projects I've ever seen.
Over the next few weeks, they continue to strip out the building. And while the huge window openings are being cut, Jamie is also removing some of the internal walls inside so that light can flood into the former double-height control room, which he now plans to split in two. However, the more internal load-bearing structure he removes, the weaker the bunker becomes.
Pecking it, there's a lot of columns moving.
Too much vibration on that beam, isn't there?
The builders look worried.
That is a lot of weight on top of there, hell of a lot.
There's a crack that side there. There's a crack this side here as well. It's too risky with the machine we've got. We're taking the strength out of the building, yeah. And that could get worse, so I think we're going to have to abort.
All work has stopped on site while they investigate the structural problems with an engineer. And until they find out how bad the damage is, Jamie's dream of restoring this bunker hangs in the balance. It's the height of summer at Watnall in Nottinghamshire. And with good weather and no sticky mud, Jamie is keen to push on with the project. But the demolition of internal walls and the cutting of large window openings has created worrying cracks that possibly threaten the stability of the bunker. Work has stopped on site as they await the verdict of the structural engineer.
So yeah, the first one is just up here. You can just see just inside of the pillar. It's just a fracture or crack line.
It's just peeling off.
Right, okay.
So that's okay. It's not okay. A problem.
Cool. So that was the main concern, and we've got exactly the same on the next pillar down again.
The amount of reinforcement in that beam.
Yeah.
For that span is unbelievable.
Yeah.
So I don't expect it to go anywhere, to be honest.
Because the original steel reinforced walls are so thick, the structural engineer is confident the worrying cracks are just superficial.
Obviously, the risk or the worry, if it was something like a fracture and that's going to give, that's, you know, project over. You know, that would have been our dream gone, I guess. But no, it's good. Good news. So, all steam ahead.
It's now a year into the project, well past Jamie's original six-month deadline to move into a small apartment at the front of the bunker. I'm back on site to see the giant window openings that are now finished.
What a difference. Just all of this has been dug out. You now feel light coming in towards the building. Oh, man, look at that. God, those openings that they've put in are way bigger than I thought they were going to be. They're fantastic, though. Tell you what, this is the first time I've ever come to this building where you can actually just imagine someone living in it. Just. Rather than it being this underground, subterranean, dark space with no natural light whatsoever, you've now got an elevation of a building, a facade with openings in it.
Jamie had originally budgeted £30,000 for the excavation of all the mud, but he's ended up spending double that. It's also cost an extra £30,000 creating the new giant window openings. That's £90,000 just to get to this point. It's a fantastic transformation, but I'm concerned that with all this structural work, he's not focusing on his original phase one plan.
I thought originally you were saying you wanted to get the bit built at the front and finish that you were going to move into by Christmas.
Yeah.
Is that, have you just forgotten about that now?
No, not at all. I mean, you know, with regards to the extension part of it, as much as it's a large cost, I don't think it's that complicated.
We'll get there in one way or another. It is amazing when you think about it. It's a year since I first came to site, and Jamie's been relentlessly pushing this build. But in so many ways, he's still just scratched the surface. There's none of the things that you'd expect in a normal building, you know, electrics, plumbing, kitchens, bathrooms, tiling, plaster and decorating. He's nowhere near close to even starting that. And the reason being, it's just so big.
Jamie is still a long way off from achieving his goal of converting phase one of the bunker, but some still remember it exactly as it once was. I've managed to track down Jerry Krybik, who worked at the bunker between 1952 and 1954, at the beginning of the Cold War, in the second chapter of this bunker's history.
So, welcome back. After all these years.
God. That is higher than
can you remember any of this?
Mm. Oh, I can remember going up steps, yeah.
Well, this is a new opening, so
I was going to say, I don't remember a space there.
No, this is all blocked up, so staircase up. But you remember the stairs, yeah?
Oh, I remember, because I was puzzled that you're going on underground and you're going up the stairs first. Yeah. I remember thinking that.
Go on, lead the way. Yeah.
In the 1950s, the bunker was guarding against fears of a sneak attack by Soviet planes on US aircraft bases in Nottinghamshire. Jerry worked as a fighter plotter at the tables in the control room, tracking radar signals.
The big overpowering feeling when you came underground, and it was great because whether it was summer, winter, cold, hot, anything, you came in here and it was peaceful and like an aquarium, you know, this nice green feeling. And you felt part of something bigger than you.
You remember this?
Oh, crikey, yeah. Oh, there were massive glass windows here that came out in a curve.
Rather really? Like,
well, the officers were up here. They had like big torches on a stick, and they would go boom, boom, like, and they could signal letters to us. X for unidentified, A for allied, F for fighter. And they could just flash this. You'd see it flashing on the table next to you.
RAF Whatnall continued tracking the movement of aircraft for another 10 years, until its doors closed in 1961. But Jerry has carefully collected and saved all his mementos of his time working in the bunker.
This is the document that says I shouldn't talk to you at all, look. Unauthorised communication by you to another person, which might be useful to an enemy in war, renders you liable to prosecution under the Official Secrets Act.
And even now, after all these years, the memories of this building are as vivid as ever for Jerry.
Incredible how it takes you back. I've got that ridiculous feeling. If I suddenly put my uniform on, I felt I could go on duty and resume, you know, actually doing it. Happy days, though.
Yes.
Thanks for reintroducing me to it.
No, my pleasure. It's been an absolute honour to show you around today.
The history of this bunker has always played an important role in Jamie and Jane's overall plan to turn it not just into a home, but also a business, a themed B&B. So I want to introduce them to someone who has also done just that. Spitbank Fort in the Solent was built in 1878, and like the Whatnall Bunker, its primary aim was to protect Britain from attack, but this time from the French at the end of the 19th century. Today, the fort has been transformed into a military-themed hotel. And I think coming here will help Jamie and Jane understand the level of detail that goes into a project like this.
Why did you convert this building into this use? What exactly have we got in here?
People are excited about doing unusual things now. They don't just want to go to normal hotels, they want to do something different. I think it's a mixture of history, but then luxury. And you've got to do things properly.
No pressure.
No compromise. There's a slight difference on budgets. And what was the kind of strategy with English Heritage in terms of an approach to restoration?
They wanted us to respect everything. Not one of the hooks that you see in the ceiling has been removed.
So it's that thing that could always be put back to its original look and use. Everything was kind of retractable.
Exactly that. These are the original 8 sinks that would have been on the fort for up to 200 soldiers. So again, English Heritage said we want to keep these, even the rust elements that are to be kept. Yeah. So all we've done is just clad them in glass, and we now use it as a champagne and vodka bar.
The fort has 8 bedroom suites and has used many of its former military spaces for luxury living. I'm hoping this will give hotel manager Jane lots of inspiration for turning part of their bunker into her dream bed and breakfast.
Does it scare you a bit as well, or not, seeing this? I mean, I know this has been a big level of investment, but do you think that all of a sudden you're going into a kind of hospitality, having to look after other people, give them that unique experience?
No, I can't wait. I'm really looking forward to it. When it finally happens that we have that bit there, because obviously that's not going to be right at the start, but I can't wait to do what you're doing. That is my forte. It'll be so nice to have something that's ours that we can do.
As autumn approaches, there's a substantial slowdown in progress at the bunker. With Jane back at work and Jamie stretched with his own furniture business, there's only a small team working on the new internal walls that will make up their temporary apartment in the redesigned scheme, using 2 of the new window openings Jamie's cut into the south wall. So I've come back to help focus their minds. It's also the first time Jane has seen the new interior spaces since finishing her maternity leave.
So is this area now, this, going to form part of your apartment?
This is our living space. So we've got dining in the end of the room.
Yeah.
Living all the way through the middle, and then kitchen, which will be
kitchen there.
This. Yeah.
This looks very manageable, doesn't it, this bit?
Oh, yeah, 100%. We're not going to be on top of ourselves. Now, we haven't got oodles of space, but we've certainly got plenty of room.
For Jamie, I think this is an achievable goal, and I hope Jane can now see the light at the end of the tunnel.
It's really nice to actually see it as a room. But we're making progress, and I think after having stopped for 3 months, it's nice to come and see that we are.
You know, now you're thinking two-bedroom apartment to move into. You kind of get your head around it.
Yeah. And yeah. We can't give up now. We've got so far.
We're just normal people trying to do this. He's project managing it. I'm trying to help him as much as I can, but I'm working full-time, trying to sort Harry out, trying to look after Jamie as well. It's hard, but it'll be worth it when it's done. And that's the main thing.
It's obviously been a very difficult 3 months for Jamie and Jane, but it's good to see that at last they now have a manageable plan. It's achievable, but there's still a huge amount of work to do.
You know, when you take on a restoration project that's this big, it kind of draws you in and it starts pulling you to different parts of the project that you didn't really intend to touch, and that's exactly what's happened here. Because Jamie and Jane have spent so much time and money on major parts of this project that were never part of their phase one, and it means it's cost them an awful lot more time and a lot more money. And the problem now is their phase one looks a long way off.
It's been a year and a half of constant battling to convert the first phase of this giant 15,000 square foot military bunker into a temporary apartment. To reinvigorate Jamie's passion for a project that was only supposed to take 6 months, I've got a surprise in store. During World War II, our bunker played a vital role in defending Britain against the Luftwaffe. And nowhere is this more evident than at RAF Duxford, 170 miles away in Cambridgeshire, where more than 1,000 missions were jointly coordinated. So I've brought Jamie here to give him one final experience that will hopefully show just how important his bunker was.
There's a letter from a plotter, and she's called Mary Harrison. She says, "Although so safely tucked away below ground in the bunker, we missed none of the excitement when one of our group fighters demolished one of the enemy planes, and also felt the sorrow when one failed to return."
Around 60 Spitfires or Hurricanes could be dispatched daily to repel the German Luftwaffe, and the average age of the RAF pilots was just 20 years old. And it was this plane, the Harvard, that they were trained in. I can't think of a better way to appreciate the critical role the plotters played, assisting those brave pilots who took to battle in the skies. This plane was ideal for preparing young British pilots to step up to the faster and more powerful Supermarine Spitfire. Once up in the air, with communication from the bunker to the airfield to pinpoint the enemy planes, they were ready for combat.
Amazing! Really is like going back in time!
The defence systems identified the height of the enemy planes so that the RAF pilots could position themselves above, then dive and attack.
Break, go.
And then it was left to the young pilots to use their aerobatic skills they'd learned in the Harvard to shoot the enemy down.
I tell you what, that was one of the most unbelievable experiences of my life. It really brought it to life, actually, just how important our military bunker was, the lines of communication between Watnall and Duxford. Knowing where the enemy were, going into battle, and praying to God that he came back. How was that, mate?
Superb, absolutely superb.
Good, eh?
Very good. Thoroughly enjoyed.
Your
thoroughly
smile enjoyed. Was like that.
I now understand why our bunker was so crucial to the safety of the pilots when facing death every time they took to the skies. I really hope that this has inspired Jamie to push on and complete phase one. It's been 3 months since our last visited site. Jamie's budget of £300,000 has been slowly whittled away by major restructuring of the entire bunker, which has cost him £100,000 so far. I was always concerned that Jamie wasn't focused enough on phase one, the two-bedroom apartment where him and his family plan to live. So today I want to know how much progress they've made and whether phase one is finally wind and watertight.
Morning.
Nice to see you.
Hello, mate.
Morning, George, you well?
You've got the glass in?
It's in. A little bit different.
And then I noticed as I was coming down the hill, that window, fantastic picture window, huge. What's brilliant about it is those windows make the building for the first time just feel a bit domestic, as if there is a home in there somewhere, rather than a big military building.
Yeah, it finally feels like it's going to be a home inside there.
Yeah.
When Jamie excavated the site, he abandoned his plans to wrap an extension around the side of the bunker. He cut giant new windows into the previously buried blast wall, allowing natural light into the building for the first time.
The kitchen window's in. Looks really good, actually. Fantastic. Before, it was just a solid, monolithic wall all the way through. I mean, you probably couldn't have taken on a more difficult project, really, could you? Let's be honest. 15,000 square foot of space, all underground. Do you have any regrets about taking this on?
No, I don't have any regrets. It's been hard, but, you know, we're getting through it.
Well, I think it's balancing this with having the baby at the same time and with both having, you know, hard jobs.
What were you thinking?
We've got something nobody else has got, and it's just...
Yeah.
Something we can play around with.
You've got something that no-one else is mad enough to take on, probably. Can we go inside?
Yeah, have a look? Just go in.
When Jamie and Jane first bought this bunker, it was cloaked in darkness, with rusty, dangerous machinery swamped by a flooded ground floor.
Something tells me that you've got a bit of a damp problem.
Now they've managed to sandblast and restructure the entire bunker, leaving clean open spaces to complete phase one and begin phase two, the new B&B.
The space is fantastic, isn't it?
Yeah.
And the light coming through there, it's just beautiful, isn't it? And actually, even now that you've just kind of plastered and painted a couple of panels of those walls, it really lifts it, doesn't
it?
Underfloor heating in there?
There's all the underfloor heating's in, both floors, top.
All the screens down?
All the screens are down.
All the structural work's done. All the civil engineering work is done. I think when I came here the very, very first time, all of this was subdivided up, there was walls up, there's a wall along there.
You bashed this wall out.
I know it looks kind of very unfinished,
yeah.
But knowing the amount of work that you've put in to get it to this stage and how much more you've got to do, there's not a massive amount when you think about it. I mean, obviously, yes, you've got to get finishes in and the kitchen in and things like that. But because you've kind of now decided you're going for a slightly more rugged feel to the space, not the pristine, immaculate finish.
No. When you took us to Spitbank, I mean, just seeing the rusticness of that and then cutting that in with the clean lines that we've got coming in, the ceiling and the roughness that we're keeping, I mean, it just totally worked there. And I think it changed our perspective totally of what we were going to do.
Finally, they've managed to break the back of this project. But to complete phase one, they've been forced to borrow some money from their family, as the bank still hasn't supplied a mortgage, as the building remains uninhabitable.
So in the bank at the minute, how much of your own money have you got left?
We've got 30 grand of our own money left in the bank.
And you borrowed how much from family
and
friends?
We've got another 70.
So you've got £100,000.
Yep.
And how much do you think it's going to cost you to finish all of this first floor apartment so you can move in?
And a bit of downstairs, 75 to 80 grand.
Oh, well, you're fine, aren't you?
Yeah.
That's brilliant. 100 grand in the pot, 75 grand to get it done and moved in.
Yeah.
Even with the contingency. There's a first.
Don't need to contingencies.
You just spend them.
I just keep going.
It's great to know that one day this colossal bunker will be brought back to life. meeting Hilda and Jerry, who worked at the base, and understanding how the building played a major part in protecting Britain has been extraordinary. And today, Jane's parents are here to celebrate what's been achieved so far. Woo!
So first little gift for you, look at this.
The RAF bunker.
This is your restoration life. Basically, the RAF bunker, lovingly restored, nearly, by Jamie and Jane, 2012.
Also as a gift to Jamie and Jane, I've managed to find the original plans for the bunker.
So there you go, a beautiful framed picture. The original plans of the bunker from 1943. I think they'll take pride of place and hear when it's all done. Well, good luck with the rest of the build as well, because I think when it is completely done, it's going to be absolutely spectacular.
Thanks for that.
Good luck. Superstar, isn't it?
Thanks a lot.
Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
For a building so huge that has been abandoned and neglected for so long, it's fantastic that Jamie and Jane even had the courage to take it on in the first place.
This was, and still is, an epic project. 15,000 square foot of dark, dingy and damp subterranean space. And in many ways, to uncover the building and to make the spaces livable, this has actually been more of an archaeological excavation and civil engineering project than a restoration one. But when you think what Jamie and Jane have achieved so far, it's absolutely incredible with such a limited budget and no building experience whatsoever. But when it is finished and they do eventually move in, it's going to be the most unique family home. I can't wait to come back.
To collect information and inspiration from the show in your own online scrapbook, or if you have a project you'd like to be featured in the next series, go to channel4.com/George. Next time, I'm going back to a remote Scottish island to catch up with a couple of artists who've restored an abandoned church. They face problems with manufacturers.
Sections that are just coming to bits.
And local opposition.
I don't think this should be restored.
From the awkward conversations to the nervous laughter to the awkward silences, back tonight at 10 for a brand new series, Re-entering the World of First Dates. Starting the shift with some paediatric trauma next, though, 24 hours in A&E. Coming up.